Very good afternoon and welcome back to the Touchline on Y254. My name is Maxwell Wasike. This point in time, we're hosting the legend, former cricket international Maurice Odumbe. He played cricket at the big stage, of course, playing against the heavyweight nations like Pakistan, Sri Lanka, India. And right now we're talking about the state of Kenyan sports legends in the wake of what former Kenya national team tactician Benjamin Ayimba is going through with regards to his suffering of cerebral malaria. And we've seen how social media users and even general public have come to his rescue, raising funds that is supposed to be his medical bill. Of course, good to see you, Maurice, man. Long time, man. How have you been?
I've been very well. Thank you for having me, Maxwell.
When was the last time you were here? It's been a while.
It has been a while. Yeah, more than 2 years, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. Well, how is outside there?
It's not easy. You know, sportsmen like myself, when there's no sports, you know, as we all know, we are actually suffering a lot. And I hope something is done very, very soon. Otherwise, at this rate, I think, I don't know what sportsmen and sportswomen are going to do. To be honest with you, it's tough.
So indirectly, yeah. You're trying to appeal to the president to reopen up?
Well, I am indeed, because people are suffering, and I don't know who his advisors are, but if only could put his ear on the ground, he will know that people are not happy. People are not happy at all.
You and Benja might have met during these international events, during your playing time, and even during your coaching times. Yes. I don't know. Yeah, how well do you know Benja? You followed what he's going through?
I have followed what he's going through, and to say the least, it is shocking. You know, for somebody of that stature, Benjamin, okay, to be going out there and appealing for medical aid. And I don't think he's alone. Even I am in the same category, and many others, and I'm not ashamed to say that, you know, because it's not been easy for me. It's a well-documented case, right? And for somebody like Ayimba, Benjamin, and I thought actually he will not have those kind of problems. And when I read that, I was like, this is not on, this is not right, okay? There's no way. You know, can you think about it? In America or in England, a former sportsman or sportswoman appealing for medical aid, you know, it can't happen like that. These are people, we are people who have given a lot for this country. You know, we are not expecting anything on a silver platter, but it should not reach to that level. He's a very good friend of mine. I've spent many hours with him, many days. In fact, we even traveled together when we went for the Commonwealth Games. In Malaysia, okay, I spend a lot of time with him. So he's somebody who's very close to me. I might not talk to him on a daily basis, but he's somebody I know pretty well.
How well do you think former sportsmen are supposed to be used, incorporated into the current setup of, you know, federations and even sporting associations and even at the government level?
You know, no disrespect to the people running sports or who are administrators in different respective administrations, but if you ask me, former sportsmen and sportswomen are not being used the way they're supposed to be used, right? And no disrespect to Nick Mwendwa, because I believe, you know, he should have had a sporting background, even if it was a little bit, especially football, right? When we have people like Dr. J.J. Mosiga, who, in my opinion, if he was the chairman, nobody will ask him anything. He's been there, he's done it all, okay? And the way he appears, you know, he appears the part. But if you look at how some of us, one day you're in, the next day you're out, you know, there's no security in your job, whether you sign a contract or not, it's never honored. You know, and this kind of treatment has to stop. You know, we should have a policy where. And I was happy to see Kayange having yes. been given a job at NOC, okay? And I'm sure he will do a lot of good things there. But others also deserve to be, you know, placed somewhere where they can make a big difference. Sometimes when I go through places like Kamukunji, where they've held so many famous political rallies, just a stone throw away, there's a ground which is slanting like this. And I'm wondering, all these councillors we've had, all these MCAs, mayors, governors, nobody can just send bulldozers and level that field for this young man to play football? Honestly?
And you've mentioned about a critical point, especially in Eastlands, part of the county. We've had, you know, emanation of talents, especially boxing. But those town halls are very shambolic. They are looking in bad state.
Totally.
And do you think that has also contributed immensely to the downfall of the sport?
A lot.
We saw what happened to Sleiman Bilali, former boxing player.
You know, I was reading that on Facebook the other day, Bilali, Waweru, and I'm wondering, and I will not even go into details how I've even moved around with Saf Bilali until even Dolo, Ruben Dolo, yes, the one who helped him at that point. But, and people seem to laugh about it. You know, I heard about Dennis Oliech. That man has done a lot for this country. You know, we should be rolling the red carpet for him. Asante sana, Bonoliege, for what you've done for us. But here we are throwing daggers at him. You know, it's like people are rejoicing for his downfall. It should not be the case. The guy did what he could. You know, we should let him be, okay? This is the time when somebody is down. You know, where is that hand? Where is that uplifting hand? You know, to tell him that you're not alone, we are with you. You know, so there's so much that is being overlooked when it comes to former sportsmen and women in this country, which is not right. And if I may add something, we need people in authority who can make decisions for the betterment of the future generation, okay?
Yes.
If I was given a chance today to be given a position where I can change the face of sports in this country, I would love that. Because, as you said, the kids in Eastlands, if they're not motivated, and that's where the talent is coming from.
Yes.
I've never heard of a heavyweight boxer coming from Lavington, you know, for example. You know, when you have people like Demo Shomondi, where are these people? You know, these are people in their days who probably have even put Muhammad Ali down, who knows? But we need to give these people a chance. Not everybody will be a lawyer. Not everybody will be sitting in front of a camera like you, Maxwell, right?
But that's very true.
Yeah, exactly. But those boys, you know, we just need to give them nice facilities and let's groom them. And we'll have millionaires, you know. We can't overlook this talent out there in Eastlands. We can't.
Someone watching is called William Mutuku, is watching from Langati. He's asking, Morris, the legend himself, to tell us about his journey from high to low and now to the stylish comeback to where he is right now.
To be honest,
I think for inspiration purposes.
Okay. Well, I don't. Do you have enough time?
Yes.
So the thing is this, okay? You know, it takes a lot of discipline to be able to reach to the level that I think I reached at that point.
That's right? Very true.
Right, and there are some things that happen that somebody cannot control. Like, for example, when the International Cricket Conference came after me, and there's this misconception that I was banned for match fixing. It was never match fixing, Maxwell. It was inappropriate
conduct.
Yes, meaning I was friends with a bad man. You know, it's like, you know, you're here, you cannot be friends with Patni, for example,
yes,
because of his reputation.
Yes.
But, you know, Patni has nothing to do with KBC and all that, but true, that's a story for another day. But it takes discipline and also listening to your seniors, because what I've realized nowadays, they call them the millennials. Okay, yeah, well, yeah, so here, they don't want to listen, okay, and they know it all. So, you know, you have to listen to your seniors. And another thing, dedication. You must be dedicated in whatever it is that you're doing, okay? There are no half measures. And when even you're talented, when you're God-given, that's when you even work harder,
true,
right? And also when it comes to the lows, you don't want to go there. You don't want to wish even your worst enemy to be down, especially when they've been up there, okay? Because at times I'll tell you, my phone never rings until I think something is wrong with it. Yeah, because the people who you thought maybe were your friends are no longer there. You become bothersome, okay? Ah, we are tatusumbua, anataka nini. But sometimes you just want to hear a familiar voice. It's not that, it's something that you want necessarily, but that's human nature. And I've come to accept that there are some things that you can control and some things that you cannot control. Like when we were playing, they used to bring psychologists to us. And they will ask us, you're going to play against people like Sachin Tendulkar, Brian Lara. what are you going to think about? You cannot think what Lara will think or what Sachin will think, but I can control.
Because it's such a milestone.
Exactly. But I can control what I'm thinking. I cannot control the weather, so I should not worry about the weather. That's an uncontrollable. So try and control things that are within your grasp, things that are manageable. You know, it's fine to think big. There's nothing, but they have to be attainable goals, right? And always take it one day at a time, step by step, and one will get there.
In your own objectives assessment, do you think the former legends for Kenyan sports are appreciated at home, even from fans themselves? Because like, there is this player who is featuring in South African League. Initially he was in Zambian League, Anthony Akumu, and even Jesse Were is playing for ZESCO United. Whenever he's on the streets, he's celebrated. And that's a Kenya playing straight overseas. And like you people, Morris, specifically yourself, you are on the streets, but even Kenyans themselves, they don't recognize you, but they will recognize Ian Wright or Wayne Rooney when he visits Kenya.
I don't know, to be honest with you, you know, and sometimes it amazes me how people can fight over Arsenal and Liverpool. And okay, fine, it's all good, it's all lovely to support a team, you know, to be a fanatic of, I support Liverpool, okay? But I will not say Mazetu Liwashinda, my team young, come on, you know, we will beat you. Those guys, the moment we turn on that telly, we are putting money into their bank accounts, right? Yet we are overlooking what we have here. So I don't know whether it's a Kenyan thing, you know, it's been baffling to me how we can worship foreign heroes and we cannot worship our own here. You know, at times, way back, I met Paul Tegart at the airport, probably he was waiting for somebody, and such a humble guy, and people were passing him, and I'm like, do they know who this guy is? You know, those kind of things. I am more respected out there than I am respected back home. But reason why, I have no idea. I don't know why we don't appreciate our sportsmen and sportswomen, even when they have the millions still, okay? We are not giving them the respect that they deserve. They don't want people kneeling in front of them. No, far from it. You know, just to appreciate them, that they are doing something for the country. That is all, right? And the rest will follow. And also, we need to appreciate them. We need to also give them something. You know, some countries, a team just wins a small event. They're given apartments, they're given I don't know what. And those kind of things, we're not even given a, nowadays, fine, I hear they're giving wheelbarrows, but the thing is, you know, they should be appreciated. You know, what is 100 million to the government to give people apartments for something well done? You know, it will not take much. We lost to Bangladesh in 1998,
yes.
ICC trophy in Malaysia, just before the Olympics, Commonwealth Games. Those people, they were all given houses just for beating Kenya. Can you imagine? And it was not even a World Cup, and they were given houses. No, you can't compare those people to Kenyan sportsmen and sportswomen. We can't just rely on athletes, runners. There's so many sprinters in West. Probably you would have been a sprinter, who knows? But we have to give them the opportunities. People talk about swimming. We have so many great swimmers out here.
True.
Yeah, so many. Now I've been reading about this, sprinter 100 meters doing 10 point something.
Yes, Mark Otieno, Ferdinand Omunyala.
You know, but if these people were given proper training, proper facilities, they'll be able to compete. I don't believe it's the Americans and the Jamaicans who can only run 100 meters and 200 meters. No. They talk about Tour de France. We have so many people ride Black Mambas without gears. So you give them...
They can also become Chris Froome.
There you go. Exactly.
David Kincha is here to mentor the upcoming talents, especially those who are passionate about cycling.
There you go. Isn't he the one...
Jason Danford is now done with swimming. We don't have proper replacements for him. Yet there are plenty of untapped potential.
You've said it.
Of course, you can be part of the program and join the conversation. What do you think about the state of Kenyan legends? Of course, a few insights coming coming in through back in Munzala, also known as Jogoya Lurambi, saying that, you know, the government should create a kitty for the sports legends so that, you know, they don't start begging for handouts and assistance whenever they are stranded. And of course, he's congratulating his son Mwilitha Lay David for scoring 391 marks, and he wants to become a lawyer and join Mangu High School. Thank you for your insight back in Munzala. I don't know, do you think that can be implemented locally, creation of a sports kitty for legends?
Of course. All we have to do is find out what other countries are doing. It's as simple as that. You mean we can't copy? You know, it's something like a pension fund where every month, you know, you go and you collect your check. It can be done. There is enough money, you know. If we can just seal those loopholes where the money that is supposed to do the right thing doesn't disappear, then I think
happened to Stadia Construction. You remember at some point Kenya missing out on hosting CHAN tournament because we were not ready facility wise.
This is it. We also lost an under-19 cricket World Cup here because we were not ready. You know, those kind of things, you know, how many jobs would we have created? So something has to be done because there's no point of looking at those trophies, you know. And, you know, talking of trophies, where is Conchestina? You know, so you will be looking at all those trophies, those bells. They will not put food on your table.
True.
All right? We don't want to be driven in Mercedes-Benz and V8s and all that. No. You know, just as long as you know you have your food, you know, everybody is comfortable. You know, that's all they're asking for. You know, they're not asking for anything big. In India, all those guys who play cricket for India, they collect their checks every end of the month. It's an appreciation. It's not easy.
At some point, you were in charge of the national team as batting coach. What happened? Are you still serving in that docket, or things went the way they went? Well, just tell us about that.
Okay, from the batting coach, they made me the head coach, and I went to Dubai. I think since they made me coach, I'm the only one who has actually won a trophy when we went to Rwanda. You know, they brought great names from great countries, Roger Harper, you name it.
Yes.
You know, so we went to Rwanda one, we went to Dubai, and when we came back, you know, I was dropped as the coach. So up to now, I don't know the reason why.
And they even never cited the reason. No, it was not official, was not professional.
No, nothing like that. They just told me, sorry, mate, you're not traveling to...
Dubai.
We had come from Dubai.
Yes.
I think Qatar. Yeah, you're not coming to Qatar. Thank you very much. And that was it. My assistant became the coach. They brought a school teacher from South Africa to be also a coach, you know, because the Mzungu was very good in taking pictures. So he's more experienced than Maurice Odombe, who's played 3 World Cups. You know. Yeah, so, but a school teacher because... is Muzungu, you know, Salavi, Morris, you know, see you around. So since then, and then Corona, of course, so nothing has happened ever since.
So as we speak right now, there's a cricket normalization committee led by retired judge Joyce Aluoch, who is now in charge after, I think, the era of tenure of Jan Mohammed came to an end, and CS for sports, Dr. Amina Mohammed, formed a caretaker committee to steer, you know, cricket Kenya to other level. What do you think about it?
You know, to be honest with you, if you ask me, even this steering committee, you know, they have to come with a structure whereby anybody who's been involved, who has held office before in cricket Kenya and Nairobi province, should not vie for positions. I think we should just have a clean slate, and the people who've gone to court, they should withdraw all those court cases.
Because sports is not supposed to be played in the court.
Not at all.
There is a tribunal.
This is, yeah, because if you look at cricket, we seem to be playing the game in the courts, you know, the corridors of courts. You know, one day an interim committee is set up by the cabinet secretary. You know, within a month, you hear people have ran to the courts. Then you hear there's a tribunal, people have gone to the tribunal. We don't need that, you know. People are suffering. I need to be involved in cricket because that's what I know, right? Dennis Oliech needs to be involved in football, right? Benjamin needs to be involved in rugby. You know, we are not the kind of people that should just be dismissed that lightly. You know, we need to be used somewhere and used properly.
Wow.
And the normalization committee, as I said, let's just hope they do a good job. because we are losing funding from the ICC.
Yes.
You know, we used to bring in almost £1 million a year. Now we are down to probably £250,000. See, and also the sponsorship, because nobody wants to touch anything that is always in the courts. So let's hope the normalization committee, but I have faith in them. I think Justice Lady Alua, she's a steady person. She's with it, and I hear there's Vikram in there. So I think these are people with, you know, proper upstanding. So they will do a good job, and I'm sure they'll want to see the game pick up and grow.
Everyone we speak to, especially legends in these respective fields of, you know, sporting disciplines, may it rugby, athletics, cricket, they say that, you know, the standards have drastically dwindled. I don't know. Talk to us about cricket during your time and what you're witnessing right now.
To be honest with you, sports has dwindled in this country immensely, and it will take time for us to get to where we were. You know, if we don't clean our house, if we don't get things in order, sorry. Countries like China are already preparing Olympians 8 years down the road. Not this one, not Tokyo. They're already looking at, is it 2026?
Yes.
They're already looking at that. When we're still looking at 2020 Tokyo. It's here, that's almost gone. But what about 2026? Who's going to replace these guys who are going to be competing in 3-4 months' time? You know, we have to think ahead, and we need to...
And outside the box.
And outside the box. And we need to have people who mean well for sports. You know, we don't want people will be going to for joyrides to Tokyo. And, you know, they will be there despite this corona thing. They will still get those certificates, traveling, whatever. They will get them, you know, at the expense of people who are deserving. So we need to get our house in order. Whoever is the cabinet secretary, you know, those trips that you have somebody, a clerk in the ministry, going for a trip with a girlfriend, they will be better off taking a former sportsman or woman to travel with the team. They will learn more than these people who are going on holidays, like what happened in Rio.
And even the 2018 World Cup, where we saw a group of parliamentarians going for benchmarking mission.
Honestly,
but whenever they come back, we never see that input.
There's never a report.
There's never a report.
This is it. You know, those are the kind of things we need to curtail. We need to get rid of those kind of things, honestly. Because there are so many deserving people, and I don't think politicians, or because you're connected somewhere, that you need to make that trip. They should get people who are deserving to go there. And we need to get things running properly. And if you ask me about football, I'll go regional. You know, I will, because when Zoya is playing with Sofapaka, what crowd are you going to get? But if you have Kisumu County playing maybe Thika United County, you know, you will get a crowd, and there'll be more sponsorship. And we need to start having these day-night games as well, because during the day it's not easy.
Maurice, if you happen to meet President Uhuru Kenyatta today, and you have your few minutes to talk to him, what will be your message for him?
My message will be, Mr. President, look into matters sports, because that's an area where it can employ so many youths in this country, and there's so much talent. Just make sure they have the facilities, they have everything, they don't lack anything, so that even after hitting the gym bag, they don't go and find you and me and they give us one, you know, KO. No. You know, let them come from training knowing that they have food, they have a little bit of money in the pocket, and that's about it. Or just to make me be in charge of making sports grow in this country. I'd like to see sports grow in this country. Just to be given that position, you handle these guys of Mtaa, those areas, and the grounds that have been grabbed should be brought back.
The argument the local sporting administrators and managers have had, they have attributed to for their failure to give, you know, former legends positions and recognize them in management dockets is because they say they don't have, you know, managerial know-how.
No. You see,
you don't need to be a sportsman.
They want a university degree from me to tell them how to organize a tournament. Honestly, what is there to do? I'm not going there to be an accountant. I'm going to give knowledge. Okay, fine. This player, this coach, why are they called technical directors? No, you can't start giving a technical director, you start doing accounts. You know, it's not on. So there are positions for this kind of people. You know, it's not we want to take from the chairman to the cleaning lady, no. You know, just positions that suits us, that is all. Yeah, and also I can also learn through the job.
Yes, true.
This is it.
Yes. Most people learn on the job nowadays.
This is it. You know, Serena Williams started playing tennis at the age of 16 and she has a degree. When did she go to school? Because there's that flexibility where she can study when she's free. So give people that opportunity, give them that chance. Let them be playing sports, but at the same time, they get to be studying.
Where do you think we're heading sports-wise? Is the path progressive or otherwise?
I like to be optimistic. Okay, I'm a very optimism person. I like to think that the future is bright. I can see the light at the end of the tunnel. Okay, it's just that, you know, it can't go on like this, you know, because guys like us, as much as we are down, we will not allow it, because we've invested a lot in our respective games just to let it go down like that. Because there's light at the end of the tunnel, and I'm sure it's not bad. It's you know, it can be salvaged. It's not too late. It's not too late.
In the event that Kenya plays Bangladesh right now, what do you think would be the scoreline?
No,
because
no.
During your heydays, it was like, you know, a titanic clash. You know, heavyweights locking horns against each other, and like. In case the same happens today, it will be a one-sided affair.
Very, very one-sided. In fact, they will not want to play us. They will probably send their under-16 to play Kenya now. Yeah, like those days. Yeah, they're not interested. They've grown big time. They've grown big time. We can't touch them. And they were below us. Way below us. We were to get tests before Bangladesh. But now we can't touch them.
How was the experience playing against, you know, those cricket, you know, heavyweight nations?
Oh, it's something else. It's, you know, because here you are, you know, playing the Australians. You know, this is their best. You know, this is a first world country. And remember, you were just a kid from Gara here, Park Road, used to play with Osogoro, right? And you're playing those guys. It's a good challenge, you see. And that is where now you also have to show what you're made of. You have to be mentally tough. You have to show them, yes, you may come from the first world. You may have all the facilities, but from Kenya, small nation, we will still give you a run for your money. And that is, it's all about confidence. David versus Goliath. It's the belief. Yeah, believe, back yourself, trust yourself that you can do it, you can deliver. See, we need to give this encouragement to the youngsters. Believe in yourself. But at the moment, the way things are, I don't think they believe in themselves. I don't think that the future is bright. Because at times, I'll be honest with you, Maxwell, I look at these kids who are 18, 17, smoking marijuana, drinking, and I'm like, will these kids ever reach 30? You know, what is our life expectancy now? What, has it dropped to what, 50? So you better be careful.
So what's your message to the upcoming sportsmen, the young talents outside there who are coming up, and your word of advice, your counsel?
To be disciplined, right? Believe in yourself, listen to your elders, don't do what you're not supposed to do, and above all, be trustworthy. Yeah, be trustworthy. Just be a person who people can rely on. Yes. Be that messiah, be that person, the one to go to. Yeah. But have the discipline, very, very important. Without discipline, you may be talented, you may have all the money in the world, but you must have discipline.
Sure.
All those other things will come. The good life, the enjoyment, they will never run away. They will always be there, but discipline. People don't get to the top by luck. It is because of discipline.
Because personally, you've seen it all. You've played at the big stage. You've enjoyed life.
Absolutely. I've seen life. I've gone down there trying to make... You know, as I said, life is a constant struggle. You know, it's never over. Just because I have a few shillings here doesn't mean everything is rosy, no. It's a constant battle. And every day we learn new things, we become better if we want to, or we become worse. So the choice is normally ours. And as they say, choices have consequences.
Yeah. How is the progress of your recovery path?
I am very good. I'm happy, I'm glad, I'm still alive. I don't know, some people might say I've lost weight. Have I lost weight or do I look fit?
You look fit.
I look fit, but yes. Some people might say I've lost weight. But under the circumstances, even if I've lost weight, I won't be surprised. There's a lot going on, you know, and hundreds of millions of people all over the world, things are not the same.
Yes, sure.
Yeah, things are not the same, but we just have to hang in there as much as it's tough, but I think some of the measures here can be relaxed a bit so that people can at least earn a bit. Otherwise, at this rate, I don't know, it can be bad. You know, it's a good thing we're in Africa, not those Arab countries. Otherwise, we would have been having sleepless nights at Stettos.
Now, as we wind up, let's digress a little bit and talk about, you know, Safari Rally SAFO. The last time it happened in Kenya was in 2002. Mm-hmm. I know you were there, you were very active, yeah, you watched the proceedings, and now it's coming back. Mm-hmm. Kenya has been reinstated to FIA World Rally Championship calendar. It will be happening this year in June to July, actually in July. Mm-hmm. And of course, it will be getting flagged off at KICSAB to Naivasha. Mm-hmm. And a lot has been put in place. It's all systems go. Okay. What's your expectation like?
I just hope it will be like in the 70s, 80s, and probably...
It was epic back then, right?
It was brilliant. It was brilliant. You know, I just used to sit by the road and see the cars just speed by. You know, it was amazing. And I just hope it will bring back that allure, that enjoyment.
Yes.
That, man, you know, you see those cars moving at
Heavy machines
at terrific speed, and I admire that. That's why I admire people like Lewis Hamilton. You know, you just kanyaga kabisa and fly. No, I like that, and I think that's good for the country.
For Formula One, you are behind Lewis Hamilton.
Of course.
He's been doing very well.
Very well. I think there's another one tomorrow.
There's a Grand Prix tomorrow.
Yeah, so, you know, those kind of things. And, you know, we need to start bringing those sporting calendars. You know, we need those. You know, we need to have these certain months. We know we'll be having rugby, we'll be having football. You know,
so that our schedule, our calendar is packed.
Look at Wimbledon. You have this, you have that. Why can't people make money? When you have all those in a calendar year, you are content. You know, maybe even once a year we say New Zealand will be coming.
True.
That's the calendar.
Well spoken indeed. Of course, now that's your camera. Mm-hmm. Talk to the nation. What's your parting shot to the entire country, to the entire sporting fraternity, and even to the cricket family?
Yeah. All I can say is that, fellow sportsmen and sportswomen, it's tough for all of us. And I just pray that things will change very soon. We are hurting, and we are hurting a lot, and I just hope President Uhuru Kenyatta, if you're watching or if you hear about this, please, I'm appealing to you, come to our aid. Vijana wanaumia, and they have a lot of faith and trust and abilities in your work. Please, saidia. And not only that, guys, Kenyans, let's rally behind each other. It's tough. You know, let's just be one. It's very important. You know, when the chips are low, you know, this is when now you say, I'm your brother, I'm going to give you that helping hand. Let's give each other a helping hand. It won't cost much.
Indeed, excellent way to wind up the interview. The legend himself, Maurice Odumbe, former cricket international, a man who played at the big stage, joining us this particular afternoon to give his insights on the state of Kenyan legends and, of course, rallying for oneness amongst Kenyans in the wake of coronavirus pandemic, and hoping that President Uhuru Kenyatta will lift the curfew and, if possible, open up sporting activities so that they can resume, and Kenyans, especially those who are passionate about sports, can continue earning their livelihoods from that. It's been an honor having you. Thank you for coming through. All the very best, champ.
Thank you very much.
This is The Touchline on Y254. My name is Maxwell Wasiki. We will be taking a short break, but the show is still on until 3 o'clock.